Hey guys, it's Dave here. Welcome back, or if you're new, welcome to the channel. Today I'm bringing you the latest edition of Space Dock Updates. We've got a ton of news coming from Rocket Lab, from Varda, from Planet Labs, Virgin, and basically everyone has something new going on this week, as seems to be the case every week in the space industry. So let's go ahead and dive right in. Okay, so first up from Rocket Lab, we're now hearing that the next mission will be called Baby Come Back, and it's actually going to include a recovery attempt of Rocket Lab's next neutron rocket. This will obviously be a marine recovery, not a helicopter catch, as they are no longer performing those air recoveries with the parachutes. The launch window for this launch will be opening on July 14th, so coming up pretty soon. The satellites will be multiple different customers. We'll have three LEO demonstration satellites, as well as some Spire Global satellites and Starlink CubeSats as well. Next up, Peter Beck did speak recently with Ashley Vance, the writer of the new book, When the Heavens Went on Sale. I'm in the middle of reading it right now and find it absolutely fascinating. So if you're interested, do check that out at your local bookstore. And if you're interested in hearing what Peter and Ashley discussed, I'll be sure to share a link down in the description below. On to Varda, who was working with Rocket Lab for their first ever space factory. We're hearing that they should be beginning pharmaceutical production anytime now. This tweet was saying next week, and it's about a week old. So hopefully any day now, they'll be starting to begin those pharmaceuticals for the first ever space factory, partly built by Rocket Lab. Rocket Lab as well is being chosen to launch a mission for North Star and Spire. Every new contract obviously helps a lot. This is a dedicated launch deal with Spire to deliver their first four situational awareness satellites to low Earth orbit for their customer, North Star. The launch window for this launch opens up in September of 2023, so very close, not launching, you know, years out or anything like that. And then some news for Astra. I guess it's up to you whether you consider this to be good or bad news. I guess it would have to be good for now. So Astra shareholders did vote to approve their reverse stock split. This is a little bit older news, but I still think it's important to discuss. Basically, this will allow them to reduce the number of shares in the company, keeping that share price above $1, which is the critical threshold they must stay above in order to stay listed on the public stock exchanges, something that's really absolutely essential for the company. Now, they could reverse split anywhere between a 1-for-5 or 1-for-15, depending on what the board decides. This has been approved by a shareholder vote just recently. So if you have 15 shares of Astra, that could very soon be turning into just one share. Now, this will help raise their share price. I think they should probably go big for this. I would say go, you know, above 1-for-5 just to make sure that they're very safe and they don't have to worry about doing another split in the future. But definitely still the troubles are not over for Astra as they try to get through to the launch of their next vehicle. In terms of ULA, I did discuss this in a previous video just the other day, so I'm not going to go into a ton of details, but ULA is delayed yet again on their Vulcan Centaur. They're going to have to de-stack the rocket, reinforce the tanks of the upper stage to ensure they don't have any hydrogen leaks and don't have any more explosions. So tough news for ULA. And we have a video from Tori Bruno here as well. The recent launch of their Delta IV rocket, absolutely cool views, but the downside of this is that this is one of the last Delta IVs that they're ever going to have. This rocket can no longer be manufactured. The factories are all shut down and there's only a couple left, and now that we have that delay on the books for Vulcan, there could be a bit of a gap in ULA's service. We also had a tweet here from Tim Ellis showing the latest test fire of their Aeon R engine for their next gen Terran R rocket. Looks pretty good. Hopefully they're making good progress on that Terran R. Personally, I don't know if they'll be able to hit the prices that Tim Ellis has previously advertised that he thinks they could hit. I find this company is a little bit too much on the aspirational side and as opposed to delivering. But I do wish them all the best, and this is definitely a big step forward for the company, as their main stage propulsion is really one of the heaviest lifts of every rocket program. And then some news from Firefly Aerospace as well. They've been a little bit quiet lately, but we have heard that the next Firefly launch is coming up very soon. Nobody knows exactly when, not even Firefly themselves. That's kind of the whole point. They have to be able to demonstrate this rapid response launch, being able to launch at very short notice. So sometime within the next week, I believe, we should be seeing the next launch attempt for Firefly Alpha carrying the Victus Nox satellite for the U.S. Space Force. Once they do receive that notice, they'll have just 24 hours to integrate the satellite with the rocket and get it into orbit, something that Rocket Lab has also been putting a lot of focus on lately, that responsive launch capability. And we have a pretty cool video here from Planet Labs. They're getting a lot of press lately as their technology is incredibly useful for the Ukraine situation and really just all over the globe for various reasons. Right here we can see that the North Korea canal has gone pretty much dry from June 5th to 28th. It's great to be able to see how these changes happen in real time, as Planet Labs does take these pictures pretty much every day. This has to do with a dam being destroyed in the area, obviously around the Ukraine-Russia conflict. More news from Planet Labs. They did get a buy rating from JP Morgan Securities analyst Trevor Walsh. He did give the stock a strong buy with a price target of $6.41, representing over 110% upside. So a strong vote of confidence from the JP Morgan Securities analyst. ASTS Space Mobile also had some news this week. They confirmed that they have 4G capabilities to everyday smartphones directly from space. Their Blue Walker satellite, which launched this year, has communicated with everyday smartphones, reaching initial download speeds above 10 megabits per second. So not massive amount of speeds there, but if you remember, you know, on the earlier days of cell phones, that was considered quite fast back then, and it can get you by for a lot of the normal stuff as long as you're not, you know, doing anything too crazy with your phone. This is quite exciting. It's a little different than Starlink, because obviously with Starlink, you need those satellite terminals, set them up, you know, on your roof or wherever you have it, point them up at the sky. This is direct to your cell phone, so no need for that middle piece of hardware. You can get internet straight to your cell phone from their huge Blue Walker satellite. Pretty exciting stuff, really. These 4G LTE download speed testing used AT&T Spectrum and Nokia RAN technology. The evaluation of their Blue Walker satellite does continue, and they're looking to enable 5G cellular broadband as the next major test. And then, obviously, big news from Virgin Galactic. Their first commercial launch is coming up extremely soon. Now, this will not be launching tourists into space as of yet. They will be launching Italian Air Force and National Research Council crews to perform scientific experiments. So obviously a massive milestone for Virgin Galactic. I'll be watching this launch myself on Friday and wishing them all the success in the world. And finally, just one other item to discuss. You've probably heard already about the recent Titanic submarine debacle, and it's been all over the press. Obviously a horrible story. I feel really bad, especially for the one business executive's son. It sounds like he didn't even really want to go on the submarine in the first place, and all members lost their lives. Sounds like there were some skimping in terms of safety certifications and stuff like that for the submarine. And a lot of people are drawing parallels to the upcoming kind of space tourism business, because this is, you know, another type of extreme tourism, going down to the bottom of the ocean where people lost their lives. And a lot of media and public are wondering whether this event, although obviously not caused by a space company, might hurt the demand for this kind of extreme tourism, seeing so many people sadly lose their lives. I do think I've never liked Virgin Galactic's business model that much, but one thing I will say for them is they do seem to take a lot of time and focus on the safety, trying to get things right after any anomalies. So and Blue Origin seems to be quite safe as well. So personally, I do think both those vehicles are relatively safe, certainly a lot safer than the submarine, but it could hurt the demand for space tourism in the future. Let me know down below if you would get on a Titanic submarine before or after this news, and if you would be willing to get on Blue Origin's space tourism vehicle or Virgin Galactic's, and if you would, which one would you prefer to ride? Which one do you think is safer? I'll check out your answers in the comments down below. That's all the news I have for you today. Thanks so much for tuning in. If you're new here, I invite you to subscribe. I come back with news around space companies very regularly, especially companies that are publicly traded on the stock market, and talk about investing in these companies as well. I hope you guys have a great day and a great week. I'll see you in the next video. Bye for now.